Today, I'm going to be talking about some of our recent work in snake fungal disease, specifically in Nerodia. I'd like to start with a little bit of an introduction. When you think about fungi, when most people think about fungi, they think about what you see in these images here, mushrooms. However, there's much more taxonomic breadth within the true fungi. And the fungal kingdom has been around for a really long time. Fungal ancestors diverged from our ancestors about 1.46 billion years ago. So they are truly incredibly diverse. And they range anywhere from the early diverged chytrids to your more recently diverged gill and cup mushrooms that you eat for dinner at your table. Of course, most fungal taxa are either benign or even beneficial. A few have even changed the course of human society, like penicillium species. Although there are some taxa that cause disease in humans and plants and animals, if the conditions are right. And these are called mycoses. Those infections are called mycoses. A lot of us might be more familiar with the skin mycoses of humans caused by common species, such as our commensal Candida albicans, which is responsible for candidiasis in humans under certain conditions when a human's immune system is affected. You can think of examples such as infants or the elderly, cancer or AIDS patients, or even transplant recipients. While humans are important to study, our research in the RDZ lab at Texas State University focuses on those mycoses affecting wildlife. And it seems that outbreaks have been more frequent in the last few decades. And the COVID-19 pandemic has illustrated how easy pathogens can actually spread globally. For us that work in wildlife, this highlights the critical need to investigate host pathogen dynamics in susceptible wildlife taxa. Now, when we think about fungal pathogens in wildlife, especially those people who are more interested in mammals, the most prominent example that comes to mind is probably white nose syndrome in bats, which has seemingly spread across the US from east to west. But in general, fungi are ubiquitous and incredibly understudied. So even marine wildlife is not safe from mycoses. As you can see in these images, this dolphin has been affected by lobomycosis, and one has actually succumbed. Now, of course, many of us with interest in herpetology, and I assume there's several of you out there, we're primarily concerned and more familiar with chytridiomycosis. Caused by species of Botrychochytrium or the amphibian chytrids. I've been working in this system for about a decade now and have investigated the pathogen dynamics and genetics of this fungus to help explain its occurrence in the Americas. So, increased study of BD has shown us that susceptibility varies greatly among amphibians, with some acting as carriers like these bullfrogs. And others experiencing major declines and extinctions, even in pristine environments like these harlequin toads of the neotropics. Although even within a species, susceptibility can vary. So for instance, in these lowland leopard frogs from Arizona, they show differential susceptibility depending on which MHC genotype they carry. So we know now that with greater than 500 known amphibian species infected by BD and counting, there is practically no demonstrated host specificity. So that brings us to snake fungal disease, which, like chytridiomycosis, is mainly a skin mycosis, albeit caused by an ascomycete fungus, Ophidiomyces ophidiocola, or OO for short. So signs of Ophidiomyces infections can range from small dermal lesions to full-on necrosis, which prevents snakes from eating, drinking, reproducing, or even escaping predators. Now, The lessons that we've learned from the amphibian chytrid system can potentially help us better understand snake OO dynamics in the wild. So as with other emerging infectious diseases, the etiological agent OO was only recently described as a Chrysosporium species first, but later it was placed into Ophidiomyces. So morphologically, OO is a hyphal fungus. It propagates via asexual spores. And as far as we have seen, it shows no known fruiting body. Now, life history studies have demonstrated its ability to thrive on multiple substrates, which suggests that it is an opportunistic saprobe that occurs in the soil. And it takes advantage of the host when conditions are favorable. So it's also unlikely that it's a highly prevalent commensal like Candida albicans on us. So phylogenetic sampling is limited. However, current data suggests that isolates of OO form a monophyletic clade. And OO is related to other known vertebrate pathogens like those that cause histoplasmosis or athlete's foot. Within the OO group, there are three major lineages that have been detected, including a European clade, a North American clade, and another potential lineage that's not well characterized yet. Like white nose syndrome in the US, OO has seemingly emerged and spread from the north east to the south and west very recently. So here you see in 2006 was the first detections, and then it spread throughout the US. Although you'll see later on that the research that we have been doing will complicate that story a bit. And in terms of host specificity, OO infections have been detected in several snake genera with no clear pattern of infection, as it does not seem to be constrained to any particular species. However, some aquatic snake species in Kentucky have been shown to have higher prevalence, and this may be due to some freshwater snakes having thinner skin or their wintering habitats being favorable for OO growth and decreases in immunity as they get colder. Another complicating factor is that individuals can actually test positive for OO but not show lesions or other signs of SFD. So detection of OO doesn't mean snake fungal disease. And clinical signs, you know, may be attributed to injuries or other infectious agents, other fungi or bacteria. So currently there are about 30 species that are known to harbor OO occasionally, but as we have seen in the amphibian chytrid system, that number is likely to increase in the future as we sample more. So the research that I'll present today has been framed around the conceptual model of the disease triangle. And that model illustrates the connections between the three components that contribute to the presence of the pathogen and the manifestation of the disease, and namely the pathogen, the host, and then the environment. So before our work, only a few cases of SFD were previously confirmed in Texas. There was likely an infection in the blotch water snake, although it didn't test positive via a genetic test. There are also confirmed infections in a patch nose snake and another in the Brazos water snake. Now, you know, Texas is important because likely owing to our incredibly diverse ecoregions that encompass very wide latitudinal and longitudinal extents, Texas hosts the highest snake diversity in the U.S. and Canada. And as we've seen in OO, it has shown very little host specificity, which highlights the potential for SFD outbreaks in the state, especially in range-restricted aquatic snakes. For example, the Brazos and Contra water snakes, which are subspecies of Nerodia harderi. I first encountered Nerode Hardarai as a PhD student at Texas Tech when I volunteered to help catch them for a project that was led by the late Dr. James Dixon and in collaboration with Dr. Mike Forstner. So Hardarai is likely the most range-restricted snake in the U.S. It only occupies the grayed out regions that you see here, and it's only found in the Brazos and Colorado River drainages. It's phylogenetically, it's most closely related to Nerode cypadon and likely represents a glacial relic. So locally, I've never found them more than a few meters from the water's edge because they have a very high affinity to the water bodies that they inhabit. So the patches of river that they occupy effectively encompasses their range, which is very, very small. Now, that initial survey work led us to investigate their population genetics to follow up on previous work that had been done by Francis Rose and my PhD advisor, Lou Densmore. And what we found was that they showed very low genetic diversity and in both subspecies compared to blotch water snakes, which is a St. Patrick congener. There was much lower haplotype diversity, only two different haplotypes per subspecies compared to the 12 in the blotch water snakes, less alleles per locus at nuclear microsatellites, and also half the observed heterozygosity in those microsatellite data. Now, this is somewhat expected given, again, the differences in the range size for these snakes. Again, you know, Hardarai is very restricted, whereas Erythrogaster is very widespread. Now, we also, you know, looking at the microsatellite data, we also were able to infer that there is significant population structure between the two subspecies and even within one of the subspecies. So this suggests that there is, you know, strong phylopatry and also low vigility. So these snakes basically occupy the habitats that they're found in and likely that they're born in. Now, we know that mycoses can have a greater virulence on an immunocompromised host. And they also act opportunistically in favorable conditions, regardless of what the host immune response is. And we also know that small populations have been, you know, major concerns for managers because of the downstream genetic consequences, namely the loss of additional genetic diversity through increased inbreeding. So less genetic diversity can then represent lower evolutionary potential for organisms to adapt to changing environments, like the climatic shifts that we've seen in the last 50 years that are most likely anthropogenically driven. So this was the foundation of the dissertation research that is being carried out for my PhD student, Stephen Harding. So he has predicted that these genetically depauperate and small population snakes might be more susceptible to OO infections compared to their St. Patrick congeners. So to test that hypothesis, we collected snakes as part of a TPWD-funded project on the Brazos water snake. And we focused our searches and trapping in aquatic habitats within the range of the Brazos water snake. And when we caught or trapped individuals, we inspected them for lesions, and here's an example of a lesion, and we recorded those. We then took swabs of the snake and extra swabs of the lesions for later isolation efforts of the fungus. We also collected blood and basic, you know, metrics such as sex, snout to vent length, tail length, and mass. So, you know, once we were done with the snake, we marked them via cauterization using a specific pattern so we can identify recaptures when we went back to those sites. Now, one thing that we learned in our Kitchard work and when dealing with pathogens is we have to follow biocontainment and disinfection procedures to prevent the inadvertent spread other fungus via our research actions. So we made sure to disinfect equipment. So after we collected the swabs and samples, then we went to the lab. And in the lab, we extracted the DNA from these swabs using the PrepMam reagent, which is a proprietary reagent from Applied Biosystems. And we ran quantitative PCRs using the assay developed by Allender et al. 2015, which targeted the ITS1 region, which should have many copies in the genome and allows us to have very high sensitivity in terms of detection. For us, we like using the Fast Advanced TACMAN Master Mix, owing to it being thermostable, and it's very robust to inhibitors. And these are also the reagents that we use to detect BD in amphibians. And that's important because, you know, a swab is effectively an environmental sample, which may have way more PCR inhibitors than, say, a pure tissue sample. So we also extracted DNA from a pure culture that we ordered and quantified it on a qubit to create our standard curve. So that way we know about how many copies or how many nanograms of DNA we have or femtograms of DNA we have on that swab. So also using the lesion swabs that we took, we attempted to bring the fungus into culture for isolation, right? So we can actually grow it and have more DNA that we can use to sequence. And once we had those cultures, we did exactly that. And with that extracted DNA, we were able to amplify three DNA regions and sequence them. And we're able to compare that to previously published work. So we know what the fungus, what the phylogenetic affinity of the fungus is in Texas. So overall, the prevalence of OO among Harderi and its sympatric congeners is summarized on this map. And here, the relative size of the pie charts indicate the sample size, and the red indicates the proportion of positive samples compared to the negatives here in gray. What we found is that OO is pretty widespread in the drainage, but there is some site-to-site differences in prevalence. So lesions are one diagnostic for OO. But snakes, of course, can become, you know, injured a variety of ways. So we recorded the presence of lesions along with the occurrence and confirmation of OO via qPCR, as has been done in previous studies. And what we noticed is that there is somewhat of a seasonal pattern in the prevalence of OO, and it tends to be higher when the snakes are emerging and breeding. So this may actually contribute to its spread. Seasonality has been detected in other pathogens and also may be important in mitigation strategies. For instance, you know, potentially treating snakes immediately after their spring emergence, because hibernacula may serve as a reservoir for OO when the conditions are optimal, and shed skins in the hibernacula may serve as a substrate to maintain the fungus over time. Now, we did manage to culture some of the isolates from the lesions that we sampled. And when we incorporated those sequences into a phylogeny with other global OO representatives, the Texas isolates had the exact same sequence as those found in the Northeast and were more generally closely related to those from the US. So from the US clade, which may explain its origins. And this is as opposed to those other isolates that were detected in Europe. So we know that the fungus that we detected in Texas is what has been found in other places in the US. But here's the kicker. We also found that Harderi has a higher prevalence than its sympatric congeners. And this supports Stephen's hypothesis that Harderi would be more susceptible to OO infections compared to their more widespread Neurodia. Of course, this raises conservation and management concerns specifically for the Brazos water snake. But this result, while it's interesting, it led to additional questions regarding the historical presence of OO in the state. And if I may briefly go back to BD, in two of our previous retrospective studies on chytrids, we actually leveraged museum collections to get a better idea of what the historical dynamics of BD were in South America. And two of the key findings were the detection of BD before known global amphibian declines and before the bullfrog and Xenopus trade began. And these activities were suspected of contributing to the global spread of amphibian chytrids. And our data suggested that chytrid was already endemic in some regions of South America. So mimicking our retrospective studies in BD, we sought to leverage regional museum collections at A&M, at UT Arlington, and also UT Austin. And to see if how far we can go back and detect the presence of OO and Erodia from Texas. And, you know, Hardarrhyia is not an easy snake to come by. And, you know, as they're only locally abundant in some areas and only sparsely abundant in between those areas. So for us, museums were a very good resource for us to get increased sample sizes. So what we did is we specifically focused on swabbing lesioned snakes. So we did a survey of which snakes had lesions and which snakes did not have lesions. Again, following the procedures that we use for those BD studies, we made sure to rinse the specimens and trays that we use with fresh ethanol and changed our gloves for each snake so there wouldn't be any cross-contamination. We also swabbed some negative controls, in other words, snakes that had no lesions, which turned out to be all negative. So we are confident that the OO that we're detecting is going to be from the lesion and not from the environment or the jar. What we found was that OO was historically, geographically widespread. With the earliest detection in a blotched water snake in 1936 from Walker County. And while the prevalence of lesions doesn't show much of a trend over time, the prevalence of OO on those lesions does seem to increase, even though we do need to supplement with more recent sampling. This indicates that, you know, snakes get hurt, they get lesions, they get blisters, but sometimes those blisters, again, aren't associated with OO. But what these data show is that later on, those lesions have a strong association with the presence of OO. Of course, because, you know, these are museum collections, we're able to sample a greater taxonomic breadth from those collections. And they held the same pattern retrospectively out of the snakes that we sampled with the lesions, where the Hardarrhyia subspecies showed a higher prevalence compared to the other Nerodia species. But we also confirmed infections in Clarkii and Fasciata, but interestingly, not in Cyclopean. So that's something that we need to investigate a little bit further. So there's a lot to much more here to unwrap, but to summarize, we know that the pathogen has, you know, been historically present at least since 1936 in Texas, and that sampling again was limited because the museum sampling itself is limited, but we did show that several taxa are now confirmed to be hosts of the fungus. However, you know, one species, Nerodia hardarrhyia, shows increased prevalence, not only in our contemporary surveys, but also in those retrospective surveys. And since the pathogen and the environment are effectively the same, it means that the host pathogen dynamics seen in the Brazos water snake, we speculate, could be attributed to the effects of small population sizes and inbreeding in the Brazos water snake rather than the pathogen or the environment. So we now have a new TPWD-funded project to survey concho water snakes. This is Nerodia hardarrhyia passamaculata in the Colorado River drainage. And we will perform the same analyses that we performed in the Brazos water snake to, again, confirm that pattern in the contemporary surveys compared to the retrospective surveys. So with that, I'd like to acknowledge all our collaborators and colleagues and landowners and the people who also helped us in the field and the lab, especially our undergraduate field crew. These people are amazing. They're really hardworking and talented. So if you see these names come across your desk, hire them. They're really good. Also, the grad students that have helped us in the field, who use their time to help us in the field and traveled far distances sometimes. We appreciate your help, so thank you very much. And with that, I'll go ahead and take any questions.
Yeah, thanks, David. There is one question in the Q&A so far. So if there's any other questions that are on your mind, please go ahead and enter them into the Q&A function and read them out for David to answer. But this question that's in there currently is about the kind of phylogenetic history of the Brazos water snake itself. And the question says, you mentioned that this species could be a glacial relict of the northern water snake, right? But how could this be when glaciers reportedly did not extend south of, say, St. Louis, Missouri, thus never reached current day Texas?
So, and again, you know, I speculate that there was a proto-Cipadon-like ancestor that likely occupied, you know, all of the that whole region below the glaciers. And as they retreated, that proto-Cipadon thing eventually became Cipadon, and then the Harderized subspecies remained in these drainages. And again, very specific habitats, so riffle habitats, you know, they aren't found generally throughout the entire river system. They're only found where they can actually hunt and breed. So again, I'm speculating that there was this proto Harderized / Cipadon thing, and then, you know, eventually Cipadon diverged into that species and Harderized diverged into Harderized. Let me know if that was useful.
No, that makes a lot of sense. Sounds like a similar model, what we think for like Houston toads and other taxa, right?
Yeah.
Across the south. Okay, the questions are starting to come in now. There's a question here about compensating for low seasonal sample size in the prevalence data. So we got a bunch of white nose people here, right?
Right,
how do you compensate for low sample sizes when the fungus is most prevalent and higher later on? Is that a function of survey effort? And is there a way to compensate for that?
Yeah, so I mean, the problematic thing is, you know, snakes, they're abundant seasonally, right? And they tend to disappear in the winter and when it's brutally hot outside. So compared to say amphibians or even bats, you know, we can go to a pond in the middle of winter and you're still going to find amphibians, but snakes will be in their hibernacula, which typically aren't accessible. I mean, that's a really good question. And I don't know exactly how to answer it. I mean, there's, you know, what we don't want to do is disturb the snakes when they're estivating, right, in the middle of the winter. And we don't want to destroy their denning areas. So it may be that more effort will increase sampling, right? And that's one way to do it. But I just think that the sampling is always going to be lower, you know, in the winter and in the middle of summer, no matter what we do.
Yeah, great. Okay, here's another one. Is there any data for prevalence of OO in Cipadon populations nearby?
So that's a really good question. But I wouldn't consider that Cipadon is actually nearby. And I don't know if it's been detected in Cipadon. I don't know the answer to that particular question, but I don't know. I just wouldn't consider Sipadon nearby. Again, looking from the perspective of the snake, which has shown, you know, really strong phylopatry and very low agility. That's, you know, a world, Sipadon's a world away, right, up north.
And ecologically too, maybe, by the
yeah, they're very different ecologically. I mean, you know, I know Sipadon can, I've seen like videos of them diving really deep, you know, and they're really deep water and stuff. And Harderite just, they're, you know, closely associated to the banks of the water bodies, the edges of the water body. And, you know, they're kind of, I always say this, they're kind of like sorry excuses for water snakes. They tend to be small, you know, and susceptible to predation, not only from other snakes, but also from, you know, birds and fish and whatnot. So, yeah.
Okay. There's another question here. Has OO been detected in other aquatic reptiles?
Oh, that's a really good question. And I don't know the answer to that question. But again, as we see with a lot of opportunistic mycoses, right, if the conditions are right, it's likely that that could happen. I mean, that would be a really cool experiment, you know, to do. And what kind of aquatic reptiles did you have in mind? I mean, what are we talking about, like, you know, basilisks or something like that, or, you know, something that is much more aquatic? I don't think it would work with marine iguanas.
Yeah, right. Okay, we got a lot of questions coming in now. So, a question here: how did you detect OO in museum specimens? I think you talked about it a little bit, maybe embellished a little bit.
Yeah, no. Again, the purpose was to first go into the museum collections, and look at as many snakes as we could, and try to find evidence of lesions, you know, that would look like this. So we looked at snakes that didn't have lesions, you know, and we set those aside, and then we found the ones that did have lesions, and specifically those that had lesions, we rinsed them, obviously, and then we swabbed that lesion. So we can get the genetic material of the hyphae. If OO did cause that lesion, then it's likely that in the matrix of tissue, there's going to be hyphal material or even spores in there. And that's what we were targeting. So we didn't take biopsies or anything like that, but we swabbed those regions that looked pretty much like these two that you see on the screen. So then we took those swabs, we extracted the DNA, whatever DNA was on that swab, and we ran that through a quantitative PCR assay to detect the presence or absence of OO.
Got it. Okay. Has there been any difference in OO prevalence in the sex of Nerodia species that either you've looked at or you're aware of?
I don't think we've explored that in our data, but it shouldn't be too hard to do. And that's a really good question, too. We need to go back and actually just run that analysis and just partition the data by sex. But what we do know is that larger snakes tend to have more lesions and more OO, or have more prevalence, higher prevalence of OO. Neonates, juveniles have much lower prevalence. But once they become adults, they seem to have a higher prevalence. So OO, I mean, well, SFD is, you know, a chronic mycosis. So, you know, it lasts a long time, and it could be that, you know, the longer something lives, the worse that mycosis is going to get. But if that pattern holds, typically females tend to be larger. So there may be something there, But yeah, we'll definitely look into that. Good question.
Yeah, that's a good question.
Sex-biased infections.
Okay, another question here. How many recaptures did you encounter? And then some follow-up kind of questions to build on this is, what are your thoughts on the efficacy of branding as a long-term mark retention method? And are there any concerns for promoting OO infestation by marking the snakes using that method?
Yeah, no, that's a really great question. And I'm happy to address it. So we actually didn't get that many recaptures. We in one place where they're hyperabundant, we did get recaptures even I think even the next year. But the number was relatively small. But we do see them. And I think if we survey more often, because these were kind of like punctuated surveys. So in the Brazos, we did punctuated surveys where we would go out for 2 or 3 days. But in the Colorado River drainage, we're going out for 2 weeks, 10 days to 14 days, and sampling sites twice in that sort of period. So in that sense, we find more recaptures. So I think that's just a function of survey effort. As Paul suggested earlier. Now, in terms of the branding, I think that's a really good question and something that needs to be addressed because, I'm always, I mean, one thing that we could have done is, we could have put transmitters in the snakes, but, I had concerns about, you're breaking effectively the protective barrier that the snake has, right? The physical barrier that it has to an infection by the fungus. So, we opted not to do that for the Brazos survey, and I think it's something that we still need to consider. But in terms of the branding, so the alternatives are, we put a transmitter in them, so we open them up, or we do scale clips and do it that way. But then you're still creating this, wound that may potentially serve as an entry for OO. With the cauterization, I felt a little bit better about that because you're cauterizing the tissue. So it's not like it's an open, fresh wound. It's a cauterized wound. Any spores that are on there are going to be, eliminated via the cauterization. So it works really well for larger snakes. It doesn't work so well for smaller snakes, but in my professional opinion, I think it's probably one of the better ways to mark snakes. And we didn't see, say, an infection starting where we actually cauterized the snakes. So that's not something that happened. And again, that's something that needs to be addressed in a study where we're looking at, disease progression. So we're looking at the same individual, at the beginning of the year, at the end of the year, and then the next year, and the next year, and the next year, to see if that's an effect. But in the few snakes that we recaptured, we never saw, say, lesions forming where they had been cauterized. Great, great question.
Yeah, that was good. So we got a question here from so it looks like somebody from Arizona. So they found OO in wild snake populations in Arizona in 2019, including the federally listed Thamnophis rupipunctatus. Did you have any trouble amplifying DNA from the museum specimens? I guess they're, thinking about doing a retrospective study or have done it.
The qPCR assay, and this, this is sort of related to the BD studies that we've done. The qPCR assay is based on a very short DNA fragment. I'm not sure. I forgot how long this one was, but the BD one's like 120 bases. I think this one's smaller. Could be like 80 bases or something like that. Degradation of DNA is, a major concern in when you're trying to amplify things or detect things. So if you're talking about a 200 base pair or greater fragment, the likelihood that you're going to amplify that is very, very low in preserved specimens. But when you're talking about smaller things like 100 base pairs or less, you're more likely to amplify those. So is there, I think part of that question is related to, you know, false negatives, right? Where we get a negative result, but there was OO there, and it's not due to, you know, it's not due to it's due to DNA degradation, right? Not that O was not there. So in our retrospective study, we likely underestimated the prevalence of OO, and likely because of some DNA degradation or decreases in the amount of DNA. But I have to say that the qPCR assay is robust to DNA degradation to some point, right? So I think you can get a much better idea of what the retrospective prevalence of OO was if you do go and sample snakes now or preserve snakes. Now again, what we did was we only swabbed the snakes that had lesions, right? So to save, you know, funds here and there, because there were thousands and thousands and thousands of snakes, and this stuff gets really expensive. So we specifically focused on those snakes that had lesions. And, you know, again, the null hypothesis is that there's nothing there, right? But that's not what we found. So we found pretty decent prevalence across time. So I would encourage you, I would definitely encourage you to leverage your museum collections, and it also highlights one of the importance of why we should continue to, you know, submit things to collections.
It's also another kind of question and comment about that, and that is, were any of the museum specimens formalin preserved, or did you only use ethanol preserved? Asking because formalin could cause mutations and create an underestimate of prevalence.
Absolutely. So we don't know what the preservation method was, right? What we did experience in the amphibian stuff is that the older samples, the older accessions, were ethanol preserved, whereas the later accessions were formalin preserved and then stored in ethanol. So I agree that formalin causes, again, some issues with DNA. But when you're talking about really short fragments, that kind of offsets, you know, it can offset that damage. Now, are you going to be able to sequence the OO that's on preserved specimens? Likely not, you know, especially if that fragment is larger than, say, 100 bases or something like that. But the qPCR, again, is robust to a point to that DNA degradation. And the issues that it may cause with formalin. So that is a concern, but unfortunately that's something that you can't really do anything about. And you sample what you have. And of course, in a discussion or something, you have to address that and say that maybe, you know, we are underestimating because some of these might have been stored in formalin. Some records aren't all that great also for museum specimens. So, you know, you don't know the history. So you gotta go with what you have.
That's great. It's been a clarifying question. I guess I butchered the question about Cypodon when I asked it. And I don't know if you know this, David, but just to throw it out there, the question was really about the susceptibility of OO in Harteri compared to Cypodon. You know, would you predict that would be about small population sizes, the ecology of Harteri, or phylogeny? That was kind of the basis of the question.
Oh yeah, no, that's an excellent question. So yeah, is it phylogenetically derived, or does it have to do with the characteristics of the population? So in the Burbrink paper, you know, we saw that there really is no phylogenetic association. I would guess that Cypodon likely has higher genetic diversity than Harteri. But it would be a really nice comparison, right? Because there you're controlling basically for phylogeny, because they form a clade together. Based on, I don't know a ton about Sipadon, but based on what I know, I think their populations are much more widespread and larger, even though, they're considered threatened and whatnot, but they're not as restricted as Hardori. And I mean, people have done the population genetics of Sipadon, so it's easy to look at, the number of haplotypes that they found and the number of alleles per locus that they've seen in microsatellite markers, and compare that with Hardori. But my prediction is that they're probably going to act more, right? Like Rhombifer and Erythrogaster in terms of infection prevalence. But of course, they're way up north, right? So it gets colder up there.
I think I just quickly looked at the range map actually, as we were talking about Sipadon. I guess there are Sipadon in Oklahoma, right? I don't know if there's been some changes to the taxonomy since the book I'm looking at.
But again, from the snake's perspective, it's still kind of a world away. That I mean, even within their own river, they don't go very far. One end of the river system is a world away, So in the snake's perspective, it's a long ways away.
So another question here, kind of zooming back out. Are we seeing more SFD in aquatic species compared to more terrestrial species?
You know what? That's a really good point. I mean, I'll go back to this slide over here. In Kentucky, that was the pattern, right? So that's exactly what they saw, is that aquatic species compared to terrestrial species had higher probability of or had a probability of a positive PCR. So, to me, that is a nice generalization because from the perspective of the fungus, it makes sense. If you think about the hibernacula of, say, a rattlesnake compared to some Neurodia, it's likely going to be, higher humidity, always near water, and that may contribute to, again, maintaining the OO in those hibernacula. But of course, it's been found in terrestrial species too. But I think that's a pattern that we're going to see over and over again, whereas these aquatic snakes, freshwater snakes, will likely have, and again, I'm speculating, more OO. And there's also, you have to also look at the anatomy of the host itself. And some aquatic snakes tend to have thinner skin, and that may make them more susceptible to OO infections. Yeah, good question.
Are you worried about the population level impacts of SFD on Hatteri relative to the other threats in its range?
Yeah, that's actually a re another excellent question, and it's something that, we also in the amphibian chytrid system, we have to think about too, because habitat destruction, climate change, pollution, are much bigger drivers of declines than say disease, even though the disease is a really bad thing locally, right? In this case, for Hardori, you have local maintenance of populations in very disjunct sort of areas, and I think habitat change has caused that, right? So that's one effect, but that's, in the past. The inbreeding has been caused because, again, they show very, very low vigilia. So that's just, a biological care, an ecological characteristic of the host. I am concerned because, again, OO seems to be more prevalent in those populations compared to their sympatric congeners. If you're already decreasing in in diversity and evolutionary potential owing to these other, you know, factors. And then you add disease, you know, within the last, you know, say 100 years. Of course, you know, when you think about evolutionary time, 100 years is nothing, right? But if you add this additional component to that, then I feel, you know, that it is a major, major concern. And I think that, and again, two things that I think may need to be done. And again, I don't have data to back this up. So please, you know, don't take this as scientific fact or anything like that. But, you know, two things that I think that we can do for harder rice specifically is increase available habitat to them. And two, I think they are good candidates for mitigation of fungal infections. So if we do see one that has lesions, then we have some sort of treatment protocol for those particular snakes. But again, we have not done the background research to support that. That's just sort of what my instinct says. Yeah. And to update, Stephen just ran a test, and there's no significant difference between males and females in terms of OO prevalence.
Good science in real time here. I love it.
Yeah.